is the carrot of justice really changing that much?
Well, what is justice? I mean, what does justice mean? Does justice simply mean that a person who has been charged with a crime is going to be acquitted? And that's what happened, of course, to Erica and Bobby and Huey and the New York 21, and partially in the case of the L.A. Panthers, who were just recently on trial. They were acquitted, or the charges dismissed against them. But that appears to me to be a purely formalistic view of what justice is. Empty. It has no content. If you can pick out someone, single a black person, a black revolutionary out, charge him with an unbailable offense, put him or her in jail for 2 years. 2.5 years is in the case of the New York 21, I think. And then afterwards, get up with the case that you have that doesn't have any water at all, and have the jury acquit them. Is that what justice is all about? They've lost years of their life. See, what has happened in those cases is that the black revolutionary leaders have been effectively silenced. They have been separated from their people, isolated from the community for 1 year, 2 years, 3 years.
You see, this is a contrived, calculated effort on the part of the powers to be, the ruling class, to make sure that they are separated from their people.
Well, see, there are a lot of ways in which repression can express itself. It does not necessarily mean being shot down. It does not even necessarily mean spending being sentenced to prison. It can mean being detained for so long that one cannot be effective in the community. It can mean being forced into exile, as Eldridge Cleaver was forced into exile, and we see what has happened to Eldridge and what his exile has meant for his ability to be effective in the black liberation struggle here. Mm-hmm. There are a myriad of ways in which you can repress a developing liberation movement.
What is justice? It's a very good question. One we might take for granted. One we might not ask ourselves enough. Someone who understands the depth of this question very well is activist and author Angela Davis. She expresses that what we really mean when we talk about what is commonly understood as justice, police, courts, prisons, punishment, is not really justice at all, but control, division, power. Why is it so hard for us to imagine a justice beyond violence, a justice modeled on compassion? There are undoubtedly moments in our everyday lives when we've practiced such justice without even knowing it, when our friends have hurt us and we've held them accountable, given them a chance to make amends, tried to understand why they hurt us, and address this reason so they won't cause others harm again. But it's probably quite different when we think of those close to us, as opposed to those good and evil caricatures of people we don't know. This system of violence that assumes that justice is punishment when punishment is deserved, because bad people deserve to be punished, is so baked into our culture that it's hard to see beyond what is to what could be. So in this video, we ask this deceptively simple question. What is justice? Of video games. What do video games have to say about what justice is and about what it could be? Hello, and welcome to Game Assist. I'm Sara, pronouns she, they. This video was largely possible thanks to input from Socialists of Colour, a collective of activists of colour in the UK, whose recent Letters for Abolition blog series has aimed to approach the issue of prison and police abolition from various angles. For example, by looking at what it means to disabled people or to the Gypsy Roma traveller community. So this video is very much a letter for abolition in audiovisual form. Go check SOC out at socialistsofcolour.co.uk and follow them on Twitter and Instagram at @SocOfColour. Before we dive in, if you aren't a patron already and you'd like to help us do what we do, please consider pledging your support at patreon.com/gameassistyt, and remember to hit those like and subscribe buttons. As always, there will be spoilers in this video, this time for the following games. Dragon Age Inquisition, L.A. Noire, Watch Dogs 2, and The Last of Us Part 2. please also be mindful of the following trigger warnings before watching on. Depictions of murder, blood, and dead and mutilated women's bodies. Discussions and depictions of police harassment, assault, and violence, medical exploitation and disablism, sexual assault and harassment of survivors, and racialized harassment and violence. A word we're going to be using a lot in this essay is carceral. In its literal sense, according to Merriam-Webster Dictionary, carceral is defined as of, relating to, or suggesting a jail or a prison. One way to remember this might be that carceral is related to the more commonly used incarcerate, meaning, of course, to imprison. Both terms come from the Latin carcer, literally meaning prison. So when we talk about carceral justice, this means, first and foremost, a system of justice based on the use of imprisonment, whatever the motivations, uses, or effects of that might be. Michel Foucault, a French writer whose theories mainly focused on issues of power and knowledge, was particularly concerned with the carceral. In his famous 1975 study, Discipline and Punish, The Birth of the Prison, Foucault chronicles the history of systems of justice existing in Europe since the Middle Ages, trying to understand the reasons that Europe, and subsequently the rest of the Western world, including the US, abandoned public execution for its modern, widespread use of the prison. As a quick aside, if you're interested in reading more, while useful, Discipline and Punish is not easy to read. Angela Davis's work is much more accessible, and while Foucault analyzes class, Davis adds essential analysis of race and gender that he definitely misses. Her book, Are Prisons Obsolete, was certainly my introduction to these issues, and a fantastic one at that. So I'd say Davis first, Foucault later. And remember, if you buy these books over on our bookshop.org storefront, link in the video description, you can support the work we do here on our channel. Anyway, we often hear, or perhaps think without even realizing where the notion came from or when we began to take it for granted, that imprisonment is a more humane punishment than public execution. Foucault argues that it is not this moral justification that is the reason for the rise of incarceration as a virtually universal mode of punishment. Rather, the changing economic landscape in Europe, the shift from a feudal society to a capitalist one, is to blame. A change in economic structure, of course, means a change in how power is structured, and systems of punishment are designed to uphold power, not justice. With this in mind, public execution was generally good for the feudal system. It was a grand display of the excessive, violent power of the king that frightened subjects into submission, particularly because they believed his power to be divinely ordained. Additionally, serfs couldn't own any property besides from their own bodies, so it made sense to inflict damage on the body as punishment. But it did have its pitfalls, and for the ruling class under the rising capitalist economy, its judicial inefficiency, with ecclesiastical, crown, and common courts contradicting one another, was a major reason for abandoning it. To boot, the grand, violent, public nature of these executions often led to unrest from the public, even causing mass riots in support of the condemned, who sometimes appeared as heroic revolutionaries rather than objects of fear and pity. The old system also allowed individuals known as outlaws to exist. Well, as it says in the word, outside of the law. None of this chaos would do. Order was needed. The capitalist ruling class needed minimal unrest and maximal adherence to the law. This could partly be achieved by an economically and politically efficient, standardized, and far-reaching system, which would deal with the rise in crimes that threaten their power by targeting property and capital. A carceral system of justice was perfect for this. It created a standardized, written, and publicly available set of laws, which would be enforced by the expansion of a system of surveillance and policing, and the creation of a mass prison industrial labor force to further economic power. This system was designed, in Foucault's words, not to punish less, but to punish better. So, in a nutshell, According to Foucault, the economy of illegalities was restructured with the development of a capitalist society. As for the supposed humanity of this system, and this is without even detailing the myriad forms of violence and dehumanization faced by those incarcerated in prisons, Foucault says, "What has to be arranged and calculated are the return effects of punishment on the punishing authority and the power that it claims to exercise. It is this economic rationality that must calculate the penalty and prescribe the appropriate techniques. Humanity is the respectable name given to this economy and its meticulous calculations." So, carceral justice, the systematic use of the prison, is a technique for upholding power in a capitalist economy. But, as I've alluded to, the prison doesn't exist in a vacuum. In fact, Foucault basically uses the carceral as a term to relate to our entire social order. That is to say, that our entire society is structured to uphold power using the techniques of the prison. If that sounds a little far-fetched, take a second to think about how discipline and punishment permeates schools and hospitals the way it structures prisons. From childhood, we're taught that following the rules is good, and we're rewarded for it. Of course, that also means that breaking the rules is bad and deserves punishment. Feeling constantly watched, we're too scared to even risk indiscipline for the mere possibility of being caught. It isn't just teachers that watch us, but students selected from among our ranks, rewarded for using their closer proximity to us to sell us out. Kids who break rules are bad, and kids who stick to the rules are good. And bad kids get disciplined and punished so that they'll become good kids, kids that follow the rules. If they don't, they might stay bad when they grow up. They might end up without money or a job if they're bad, and then they might end up in prison. And that would be, well, bad. So the rules must be good and natural. They've always been there, after all. It doesn't matter that the rules don't serve to make kids' lives any better, that they only serve to shove them into a productive for capitalism but deeply unhealthy cookie cutter. Someone's always been watching. And this is a huge part of the power of the carceral, that it seems so normal, that it feels like there's no other way things could be. This is an intentional effect of that power, according to Foucault. Contrary to the hyper-visibility of the king's power and punishment in feudal times, power now keeps itself hidden, always looking but never seen. It knows us, but we do not know it. It knows us through CCTV cameras, medical records, identification documents, the bodies of police officers, ticket inspectors, border police, private tech companies accessing our data, knowing our faces. And if we fall out of line, maybe there will just be a financial fine, but if we don't have the money to pay that off, the prison, the psychiatric hospital, the immigration detention center. So it's never been about justice, it's about control. The concept of the carceral helps to describe and understand how systems of policing, surveillance, courts, incarceration, and punishment are woven throughout our society in order to uphold capitalist power. Expanding our outlook even further, the term prison industrial complex describes the relationship between prisons, corporations, the media, and politicians. This system creates a political economy of prisons, or, more simply put, these institutions uphold one another, therefore ensuring their self-perpetuation and reproducing the conditions of its own expansion through the exploitation of class, racial, patriarchal, and heterosexist inequalities. For example, corporations invest in media conglomerates so that media conglomerates will spread propaganda which normalizes and even valorizes the prison and legal system, a system which creates profit for them. Corporations and politicians are also closely linked. Politicians are invested in perpetuating the prison system because it keeps them rich. Sometimes the link is as clear as when politicians like Donald Trump are businessmen themselves. Factor in the military, or the parallel concept of the military-industrial complex, and we see how corporations produce or invest in arms, which generate profits from neo-colonial violence like wars over oil. We see how the media romanticizes the military and justifies wars to please its corporate and political funders. We see how politicians are invested in these wars for their profit and power. and more importantly, how the military and police are entwined, almost one and the same, both upholding the conditions of the prison and upheld by the existence of the prison and its labor. In the prison industrial complex, incarcerated bodies are turned into sources of profit, exploited for their labor, which covers both the costs of the prison institutions themselves and generates profits for corporations and politicians. The prison system has significant similarities to the conditions of slavery, as the incarcerated are socially dead. They are not legally people, as they do not have the legal rights of people. They are unable to participate in social and political life, and their labor is not waged. Or if it is, it is at a fraction of minimum wage, and they have no access to this money while they're in the prison. No coincidence either that prison populations mostly consist of racialized people. As Foucault argues, advocates for prison reform rather than prison abolition miss the irony that reform has always supposedly been the purpose of the prison, to make bad people into better people through discipline, labor, and isolation. Of course, this moral justification is revealed to rest on pillars of sand when we consider that in reality the prison system encourages recidivism, or reoffending. Most crimes are related to capital and property, usually committed as a result of poverty, border controls, and other forms of oppression. As prisoners become marked by criminal records, they become less able to find legal work. It's a self-perpetuating cycle which keeps so many working-class people, people of color, undocumented migrants, trans and disabled sex workers, and more, in a perpetual cycle of poverty and exploitation. Those who are most likely targeted by this system are those who are seen as undesirable to the state, and those who are the biggest threat to its power should they be able to form communities and build collective power. In fact, the prison works exactly as it has always intended to. Not to serve justice, but to serve power. As we've discussed, prisons were supposedly conceived as a humane alternative to corporal and capital punishment, hoping to reform criminals who are thought to commit crime due to moral rather than economic destitution. Never mind the convenient fact that the prison system is an efficient mechanism of power. In reality, incarcerated people exist in a state of living death, excluded from society with no options for improving their material reality within the realm of the legal post-release. The social, economic, and health issues that lead to the majority of incarcerations are not addressed. The carceral perpetuates itself, and violence perpetuates itself. It couldn't be more evident that incarceration is the opposite of justice, and the opposite of humane. Transformative justice is a term that refers to an alternative system of justice that is premised on the abolition of prisons, policing, and all forms of the carceral, on the abolition of systems of harm within our society which lead to crime, such as capitalism, misogyny, racism, queerphobia, and so on, on centering communities in order to work together to ensure that instead of punishing one another, we heal together. We know that the carceral doesn't keep us safe and never will, so we keep each other safe. We hold each other to account. We grow together. Transformative justice is not a complete vision, but a radically free, imaginative, and compassionate work in progress. So for those who ask, what are we supposed to do about crime if we abolish prisons and the police? I don't know what a world free from violence will look like, but won't it be wonderful to find out? Now, video games are, of course, a creative medium. More than that, a medium where the concept of play and imagination have been vital ever since the inception of the first game. When it comes to justice, though, the imagination of these texts all too often feels incredibly limited, no doubt related, in part, to the role of the video games industry in upholding the prison and military-industrial complex. So what do video games have to say about what justice is, has been, and could be? Earlier, we discussed the historical and political shift from a feudal model of justice that centered public execution to our modern capitalist model of justice that centers incarceration. a notable genre of video games that provides a vast number of worlds inspired by, at the very least, the aesthetic of medieval Europe, is the fantasy RPG genre. But what to the fantasy RPG is justice? As a case study, I'll be taking a look at a fantasy RPG with a particularly rich and interesting political environment, the third installment of BioWare's Dragon Age series, Dragon Age Inquisition. But first, what did the feudal justice of medieval Europe look like, and how did it operate in contrast to modern carceral justice? According to Foucault, feudal justice centered the theater of public punishment, while modern carceral justice invisibilizes punishment. But while the execution or punishment itself was highly public in feudal societies, the entire criminal procedure, that of accusing someone of a crime, gathering evidence, evaluating the evidence, and establishing guilt or innocence, was kept secret, inaccessible to the accused and the public. Strict rules to determine and uphold the truth of the crime and the appropriate punishment for the condemned were only known by specialists, making this process further inaccessible. All of this served to uphold sovereign power by ensuring the condemned themselves and the public could not intervene in the establishment of guilt or the decision about the appropriate punishment for the crime. The execution, by contrast, was highly public, a display of the terrible divine power of the sovereign. As Foucault puts it, the public execution is to be understood not only as a judicial, but also as a political ritual. It belongs, even in minor cases, to the ceremonies by which power is manifested. However, as mentioned earlier, it was also an opportunity for public unrest, especially as the public was not privy to the criminal procedure, but could disrupt and perhaps even prevent a public execution. Under a carceral system, this has become reversed. While the punishment itself is hidden from the public, the criminal procedure has become a highly public and theatrical affair, almost as much as the public executions of old. In the media, think courtroom dramas and murder mysteries, in which the punishment itself is notably absent, but the criminal procedure is glamorous. Prison dramas, of course, break this trend, but with few exceptions, these notably reinforce tropes about inherent pathological criminality and violence, that some people do deserve to be in prison, just as much as cop shows and legal shows. But it's not just in fiction that we're obsessed with the supposedly righteous process of establishing guilt in order to justify punishment. Real court cases are also highly publicized, with the televised trial of O.J. Simpson, for example, being one of the most notable examples in recent history. This trend has been emerging over the last 200 or so years, with a changing economy and changing justice system. The Oscar Wilde and Lizzie Borden trials are also examples of highly public events at the tail end of the 19th century. Why are trials now such a public affair? If the theory behind upholding sovereign power had been to invisibilize the process of establishing an individual's guilt or innocence so that there would be no intervention in the process, the modern technique is to publicize the criminal process as much as possible so that the public believes in the integrity, objectivity, and righteousness of the law and its proceedings. Why would we want to interrupt the proceedings when they are clearly righteous? Why would we want to stop the punishment if we never see how vicious it is? Of course, we know this isn't universally effective. There have certainly been cases in which the public have questioned the decisions of courts. But how able are people to intervene? We can't storm the gallows and save the body of the condemned about to be hanged. We could always storm a prison, but here's the thing. Overwhelmingly, while people are often willing to believe that certain people have been wrongly imprisoned, they also believe that some people are rightly imprisoned. So storming a prison isn't a popular tactic because all those scary bad people would get out and terrorize us. Instead, if we want one person freed, because we believe that person to be wrongly imprisoned and all the rest to be rightly so, we must resort to the banal, long-winded, and calculatedly impossible bureaucracy of the prison system. Take, for example, the case of Mohamedou Ould Salahi, a man who was detained in Guantanamo Bay for 14 years for being an alleged member of Al-Qaeda. In spite of an overwhelming lack of evidence and legal attempts to free him not long after detainment in 2002, he could not be freed until 2016. And then, like Angela Davis said, how is that justice when so many years of his life were taken away, when he experienced unspeakable tortures? That can't be undone, and it will affect him for the rest of his life. Another important feature of modern carceral justice, as opposed to feudal justice, is that the king's gaze was not all-seeing, and his law was not all-encompassing. The existence of so-called outlaws, as I mentioned earlier, is proof that people could not only exist outside the king's law, they could also form armed groups which could survive and even thrive so long as they could match the king's men in military might if they ever came into contact. The visibility of outlaws, in contrast with the mostly underground and invisible nature of criminality now, is testament to the inefficiency of the king's justice. By contrast, carceral justice is all-seeing and all-knowing. Foucault argues that the panopticon, an architectural design for a prison drawn up by Jeremy Bentham in the 18th century, provides a strong basis for the architecture, so to speak, of our entire social order. The panopticon featured a central watchtower and a circular arrangement of prison cells around this watchtower. The prison guards would see out of the watchtower onto any cell at any given time, but the prisoners themselves would be unable to see into the watchtower. As such, while it is technically impossible for the guards to actually look upon every prison cell at once, the prisoner feels as though they are constantly being watched, because they could be at any given time. This is very important. Carceral justice cannot actually physically see all at once, but because we cannot see it, and it could be watching us at any time, it feels all-seeing. The extension of mass surveillance into every part of our lives achieves this effect. Someone could check your ticket on the train, so better buy one just in case. Someone could be surveilling your social media, so better watch what you say online. There could be a CCTV camera on the street corner or a security guard at the club, so better not do drugs in public or risk sneaking them in. Jeremy Bentham conceived the panopticon to structure not only prisons, but hospitals, schools, and asylums as well, if that tells you anything. So what does Dragon Age have to do with any of this? Sometimes, we can be reluctant to apply political analysis to this kind of text because it's just fantasy, and when it comes to the aspects of the text which are even somewhat based on medieval Europe, it can be tempting to use a narrative of progress. This was in the past, things are so much better now, to detach oneself. But it would be foolish to dismiss either fantasy or historical fiction as having nothing to do with modern-day value systems. The people who create these texts are entrenched in them, after all. Dragon Age Inquisition is an extremely political text. In this third installment in the series, you, a customizable player character, begin the game accused of the murder of a person known as Divine Justinia. A divine is a pope-like figure in this game world's matriarchal religious institution known as the Androstian Chantry, Andraste being their martyred prophet or so-called Bride of the Maker, which certainly has echoes of Christ being the Son of God who died for our sins. A mysterious villain, known as Corypheus, has created a hole in the sky, threatening the divide between the spirit world, known as the Fade, and the mortal realm. The player character finds themselves in possession of a magical mark on their hand, with the power to manipulate smaller tears in this divide, known as the Veil. So those who initially accused you of murder become very interested in you as a potential savior. With the Chantry in turmoil over the death of the divine, some turn to you as a sort of prophet, believing you were sent by their god, the Maker. You either willingly or reluctantly end up part of an initially small group called the Inquisition, whose stated purpose is to restore order to the chaos. There is no option to refuse forming or joining the Inquisition, by the way. I suppose it would be counterintuitive to the title of the game, but believe me, I've tried. Most of the gameplay from this point centers around the goals of gaining power and influence, which are measured in points throughout the game. Certain actions gain different numbers of power points, and this accumulates to form influence points. Both power and influence see you unlocking access to new perks, resources, and reach across mainly the southern region of the fantasy continent of Thedas, where the Inquisition liberally claims keeps, landmarks, and territory, gaining agents and establishing a notable military presence. You have some choice over how the Inquisition chooses to gain, display, and exercise its power. Decisions at your so-called war table will usually give you the option to deploy your spymaster, military commander, or diplomat, each of whom will find varying violent, manipulative, or costly solutions to your problems. If all of this sounds colonial, well... If Foucault could have played Dragon Age Inquisition, no doubt he would have had a field day with it, as power is its central concern. As the player character, you have more or less become the leader of a large empire to which pretty much all others bow, an empire with a religious leader that is believed to be divinely ordained. If this wasn't obvious from the Chantry thing and its parallels to the Catholic Church, as well as, you know, the name of the game, the immediate historical and political parallel is, of course, the Spanish Inquisition. This is particularly interesting because Foucault argues that the operation of our modern carceral society has its roots in the practices of the Inquisition. Beginning in 1478 and lasting until 1834, the Spanish Inquisition intended to root out heresy across the Spanish kingdoms and colonies. The eyes of the Inquisition were far-reaching, with an Inquisition establishing a legal and police presence in each region, to the point that people often reported themselves or their community members to the Inquisition in fear of suffering worse consequences if they didn't. Much like the carceral model, public execution and punishment was not actually favored by the Inquisition, though the sensationalist article titles you see upon a quick Google search of the Spanish Inquisition would surely convince you otherwise. Public ceremonies usually centered around the announcement of the punishment rather than the delivery of it, generating a hypervisibility of the Inquisition's justice, though not so much that the investigative process itself was public, accessible, or transparent. Occasionally, public executions occurred, usually burning at the stake, but this was reserved only for heretics who refused to repent or reoffended. It was more important to the Inquisition to punish even the smallest heresy, not to punish less, but to punish better. As such, the Inquisition was able to deal with heretics efficiently and on a large scale through imprisonment, exile, or what we now call deportation, or forcing them to wear a garment that marked them out as a sinner, sort of like criminal records mark people and affect their livelihoods today. Often, the accused had their property seized by the church as well. This was a system that enforced racial and class power as much as our own does. It allowed for the mass expulsion of Muslims and Jews from Spain and created a vast amount of homelessness and poverty, disproportionately among these religious and ethnic minorities. The Spanish Inquisition was not the only European Inquisition to operate in the early modern or medieval eras either. The Netherlands and Portugal, including some of its colonial territories, had inquisitions, and earlier inquisitions in France and Italy served the same purpose, to root out heresy. Something which may, or may not, be more surprising is that an inquisitorial system is something which still exists today. Wikipedia insists that this is not to be confused with the Inquisition, a system of Catholic religious courts, but the parallel is important. An inquisitorial system is one in which the court is actively involved in investigating and determining the facts of a case, in contrast to the adversarial system, in which the court is supposed to be an impartial party between the prosecution and defense. So this idea of an inquisitorial technique, both within the context of the Catholic Inquisitions and in terms of modern carceral justice, places emphasis on the role of investigation in establishing power. To know the accused, to know the supposed truth, is to have the power to enact punishment on them. The Inquisition in Dragon Age exists in a similar liminal space between feudal and capitalist models of justice and power. The game at once reflects elements of, perhaps even a nostalgia for, pre-capitalist justice, and a normalization of the carceral. Values that weren't normalized in the medieval basis of this fantasy world, but are normalized in the modern context that the game is created in. Like the Spanish Inquisition, like Jeremy Bentham's Panopticon, like our very much panoptic modern world, surveillance is of the utmost importance to the Andrastian Inquisition. The insignia of the Inquisition features three elements. The sun, which is the symbol of the chantry, signifying religion, knowledge, and enlightenment. The sword, which is the symbol of the Templars, a militarized police arm of the chantry, which imprisons mages and polices magic, signifying military might and physical violence. And finally, the all-seeing, all-knowing eye, which is the symbol of the Seekers of Truth, a secret police force that serves the chantry, supposedly to keep the Templars in check, or to police the police, so to speak. Though one might rightly ask, who polices the police that police the police? This insignia tells us that the Inquisition sees all, and has the power to punish based on what it sees. A power that is divinely ordained, a power that is gained through knowing. There are both feudal and carceral elements to this. Policing, militarism, surveillance, violence, and the institution of religion seem to be what define the Inquisition, much like its real-world namesake. Not uncoincidentally, the Templars and the Seekers were formed out of a historic Inquisition, which existed long before the one you lead in the events of the game, indicating quite the unbreakable cycle of divinely ordained carceral violence. The mission of the Inquisition is to restore order. Order is central to the carceral. It needs to know us so that it can order us, arrange us into hierarchies so that we can be controlled. As I discussed in my video on women, writing, and mental illness in Tell Me Why, part of the reason why the criminal justice system works hand in hand with psychiatry is the way it allows for the pathologization of crime, to peddle the idea that legality is good and illegality is bad, and that people commit crime because they are bad, inherently and naturally so. The Inquisition stands for order, discipline, and control, by any means necessary. You can try as you might to make choices in the game that work towards the liberation of the oppressed, whether it's encouraging the radical Leliana to eschew violence and supporting her bid for divine, or joining with the mages as free allies, but there is no doubt that the Inquisition is a violent institution at its core. Such choices do not erase the violent, colonizing nature of the activities you partake in for gameplay purposes. It follows quite naturally, then, that as the Inquisitor, one of the powers you hold is the power of judgment. You quite literally sit on a throne and decide the appropriate punishment for various lesser and greater antagonists in the game, depending on whether they are alive to be judged in the first place. Interesting that you can judge them on the battlefield by killing them then and there. As I've discussed, the Inquisitor has a quasi-monarchical power, and is able to decide the fate of these people not on the basis of laws, but on the basis of, seemingly, whim. Interestingly, your diplomatic advisor tells you to think of the punishment that would best suit the crime, or perhaps more accurately, the punishment that would best torture the victim. This is a philosophy truer of feudal justice, when thieves had their hands or blasphemers had their tongues cut off, in contrast to the pretty much indiscriminate use of incarceration nowadays. But quite contrary to the king's justice, the Inquisitor's justice places visual emphasis, like the carceral, on the criminal procedure, the moment of assigning punishment, rather than the punishment itself. Or at least, so it appears to the player. It is uncertain how public the main hall of Skyhold, where you pass judgment, is. Equally, we are for the most part not privy to the punishment, except in the occasional case of a death sentence, though even this clip is brief, and doesn't show violence or torture very explicitly, or if you choose to visit Skyhold's prison. There is a lot that BioWare chooses to pan away from during cutscenes to reduce animation costs, but whatever the reason, the effect is the same. So what is visible to the player, and in fact for them to choose, the proceedings of justice, may not be visible to the public in terms of the imagined citizens of Thedas. Feudal norms of visibility might be the standard, at least to a degree, in this fictional world, but carceral norms of visibility are imposed upon the player, though perhaps they feel unimposing because they are so normal to us. In fact, one might even argue that the player, the mysterious presence behind the screen controlling the figure of the Inquisitor and influencing countless lives and the very political landscape of Thedas, embodies not monarchical power like the Inquisitor, but the omniscient and invisible power of the carceral. L.A. Noire, released in 2011 by Rockstar Games, somewhat flipped the script from their most famous, or infamous, franchise, the Grand Theft Auto series. This time, the player was on the side of the law, specifically law enforcement. From the start, this game has a questionable premise, and it probably tells you all you need to know that the developers, Team Bondi, were planning on following it up with a game entitled Whore of the Orient. Good thing that never materialized. L.A. Noire follows World War II veteran Cole Phelps through his career as a police officer in 1940s Los Angeles, only a couple of years after his discharge from the military. The plot is essentially split into four acts, the player solving a number of cases across four desks: traffic, homicide, vice, and arson. All the while, the narrative is interspersed with flashbacks to Phelps' time in Japan during the Second World War. Cue generic oriental music here. Many of the characters from these flashbacks, soldiers that Phelps knew from the war, become important to the story as it unfolds. Phelps is a good cop, all about objectivity, the truth, and all that jazz. But he finds himself faced by a corrupt system, where cops work hand in hand with property developers, politicians, psychiatric professionals, and insurance brokers to exploit the people of LA. LA Noire's setting may be over 70 years ago, but it has a lot to tell us about how the violence of policing is normalized and romanticized in the modern age. Not only is the game itself copaganda, or propaganda to make cops sympathetic to us, the text itself also places a notable emphasis on the media and public perception. Newspapers are a collectible at crime scenes, which trigger cutscenes that offer wider narrative context. But how reliable is this information? Certainly these days, as the carceral state protects capital, news conglomerates are funded by corporations who have a vested interest in upholding the prison industrial complex by spreading propaganda that normalizes the criminal justice system and makes a spectacle of the criminal procedure. At the end of each case, you receive feedback which is partly dependent on how your decisions are received in the press and by others. NPCs in the street make constant reference to Phelps' fame. This is a pretty good representation of the role of public perception and support for the police in enabling the institution's continued existence. It also illustrates the spectacle of the criminal procedure intended to convince us of its righteousness, to use Foucault's terms again. Violent crime is normalized as a narrative for public consumption, while the violence of the criminal justice system remains largely invisible. In the game, criminals are not seen after they have been charged. While their interrogation and judgment are hyper-visible, their violent punishment is invisible. The criminal becomes essentially dead to the player from this point. Many of these characters have received a death sentence, so this narrative death precludes a literal death, but it also parallels the social death of prisoners, again often a precursor for a literal death in the violent conditions of the prison. It's your actions in the game that sentence these people to death, whether metaphorical or literal, but these consequences are invisibilized so that you can go about being an agent of state violence with minimal guilt. It isn't the only instance in which violence is normalized, casualized, and invisibilized either. When using the game's driving mechanic, if you hit people with your car, often killing them, this has no effect in real terms on the progress of the individual case or of the game at large. The narrative proceeds smoothly, the deaths of these nameless individuals inconsequential in the pursuit of so-called justice. Perhaps even more chillingly, the only evidence of their death is a bill for hospital fees or financial damages caused at the end of each case. The lives of each of these people is something that can be compensated for with money, apparently. Such NPCs, like the criminals whose lives you destroy then conveniently look away from, are dehumanized in one fell swoop. Mere collateral damage in the pursuit of justice, in upholding the law, in the maintenance of the status quo. Very telling of the police and criminal justice system's outlook on human life. Even when the game complicates this somewhat by presenting us with police corruption or by questioning the use of the death penalty, it never questions the principle that there are simply bad people who commit violent crimes because they are bad, that they deserve to be violently punished. what the police should stand for, what the flawed but heroic Phelps represents, is the pursuit of truth and justice, which is to say, the correct application of violent punishment to those who supposedly deserve it. All of this normalizes policing, crime, and punishment, whether imprisonment or death, as an acceptable and normal feature of society, rather than the product of capitalism and its interaction with class, race, and gender. To quote Angela Davis, "Just as capitalism has naturalized poverty, crime is similarly naturalized. If crime is inevitable, then there must be more police and more prisons." Normalizing criminal justice is not just about making cops sympathetic and making the criminal procedure appear righteous. It is also about perpetuating the pathologization of criminality, or the idea that criminals are inherently bad people, distracting from the fact that crime is the product of socioeconomic factors. You know this, you've seen it time and time again in our culture's obsession with murder documentaries and fiction. Some people are just born bad, right? L.A. Noire is deeply invested in this idea of criminality, and nowhere is this more clear than in Act 2, when Phelps is on the homicide desk. This act follows a series of murders that are discovered to be the work of a serial killer, and not a purely fictional killer at that, but an imagining of the very real and very infamous Black Dahlia killer. The Black Dahlia refers to Elizabeth Short, a woman who was murdered in LA in 1947, whose killer was never discovered. The murders in L.A. Noire have no particular similarity to the precise, clean, and clinical modus operandi of the real Black Dahlia murder, but we're just going to ignore that for now. In the game, when the Black Dahlia killer is finally identified as agency bartender Garrett Mason, he fits perfectly into the serial killer trope of an intelligent, rich white man driven by his superiority complex and narcissism into murdering vulnerable women. The game sets up a narrative that his criminality is intertwined with some twisted predisposition, something pathologically fixed and wrong, rather than the product of a violent, misogynistic culture which convinces men like this that women's lives are worthless. Mason is shot and killed before he can be arrested, so this isn't particularly explored any further. The representation of mental illness and its supposed link to criminality is also explored through the character of Harlan Fontaine, psychiatrist to the stars. Later in the game, the player discovers that Fontaine has been using his knowledge of his patients to manipulate them into committing crimes that will bring profit and power to him and his associates. For example, his patient, Ira Hodgeboom, suffers from PTSD as a result of his experiences during the war, specifically his own act of murdering civilians with a flamethrower. Fontaine uses this to his advantage and convinces Ira that burning houses will help him process his trauma, when in reality, he needs these houses burned as part of an insurance scam and needs someone else to commit the arson in order to distance himself from the crime. This medical exploitation is particularly advantageous as Ira's mental illness means that people are very willing to pin the crime on a so-called crazy person and leave it at that. On one hand, it's very clear how a carceral state operates in L.A. Noire, spread across various institutions. Psychiatry, the police, the military, local government, and corporations are all connected. They sustain each other in the violence they enact across the city. Psychiatry facilitates profit-driven schemes and invisibilizes systemic violence by weaving a narrative of pathological individual criminality. The police cover up murders committed by local politicians and their families. Many police officers in the game are military veterans who committed violence abroad before returning home to commit it there. On the other hand, by no means does the game take an anti-military, anti-police, anti-psychiatry, or anti-capitalist stance. The idea of pathological criminality is 100% supported by the psycho Black Dahlia killer, and the game consistently depicts anti-communist rhetoric, even pressuring you into prosecuting communists and anarchists. This is, of course, very accurate to US police and intelligence protocol generally, and particularly during the post-war McCarthy era. But the problem is that this is presented completely uncritically, and the player has no real choice but to simply go along with it. Furthermore, a main element of the plot is the way in which working-class veterans, including those who became disabled by their experiences at war, are used by the US to further its global political interests, then discarded once they return home to no welfare, jobs, or any manner of support. Veterans from Phelps' unit end up selling morphine illegally and contributing to the criminal economy of LA precisely for this reason. By contrast, middle-class officers like Phelps himself are lauded as war heroes, though it's later revealed this story covered up the fact that Phelps commanded the murder of civilians in Japan, because the military needs to spin a narrative of heroism. Nevertheless, being a soldier is still constructed as inherently heroic, and even Phelps is able to redeem himself through his intelligent police work and his death as a martyr, because police work, any work in service of the state, is heroic too. Never mind the constant, normalized, misogynistic, and racist violence that we witness in the game. When his colleagues say something disgusting, Phelps is silent, refusing to call out their dehumanizing views of women and people of color. He's focused on his good, noble, objective pursuit of the truth, right? But his actions in doing so are consistently violent as well, including, but not limited to, harassing young girls, including sexual assault victims, destroying the livelihoods of working-class people of color, and straight-up murder. The good cop, bad cop game mechanic quite literally means that often the only way for you as the player to get the correct outcome is to harass, intimidate, or assault someone into giving you more information, often vulnerable women and people of color. This, of course, implies that sometimes such actions are necessary in your pursuit of the truth. The ends justify the means, right? So what kind of justice is this, and for whom? A violent justice that we never see on screen because it's too horrific to witness. A violent justice that begets further violence. While L.A. Noire aims to position the violence, racism, and misogyny represented in the game as a product of individual bad cops, bad soldiers, and generally bad men, it couldn't be clearer that to be a cop, a soldier, an agent of the state, no matter how good your intentions, is inherently violent. Any criticism of the system that the game has to offer is half-baked at best, and this isn't to say that a game where you, the player, occupy the role of an agent of the state is impossible to mold into a radical and critical narrative. Take, for example, Papers, Please, where you serve the carceral state as a border control officer, but the game design frames the mundane violence you commit daily as increasingly uncomfortable, increasingly difficult, with the option to refuse to comply. Sure, we can critique how refusing to be complicit costs you your own livelihood, how we are presented with no real alternatives to state violence, or how the game's Soviet-esque setting detaches it from the violence of capitalist border control, but nevertheless this strongly contrasts the way in which L.A. Noire normalizes and even romanticizes state violence through gameplay and narrative. Ultimately, these institutions are inherently violent and they must be dismantled, but no imagined alternative is explored by either game, and opportunities for resistance are limited even in Papers, Please. Furthermore, L.A. Noire's historical setting, while normalizing carceral violence that still exists today, simultaneously distances its overt misogynistic and racist violence from the present using its chronology, suggesting that such a culture no longer exists in modern-day policing. Of course, this couldn't be further from the truth when we consider the gendered and racialized deaths of George Floyd, Trayvon Martin, Mark Duggan, Stephen Lawrence, Breonna Taylor, and so on, as well as the fact that Sara Everard's murderer was nicknamed the Rapist by his colleagues. Even if the criminal procedure is taken to its natural completion, how can we consider the literal or social death of criminals as justice when it merely perpetuates further violence, both in the criminal procedure and in the punishment itself? Who does this heal? Who does this help? Suffice to say, there are no good cops. All policing is violence, and to be a police officer is to enact violence, because the institution and the laws it enacts are inherently violent. They operate not to protect us, but to protect capital. They operate not for justice, but for power. This is absolutely evident in L.A. Noire, no matter how much the text itself tries to deny it. Now, a game that was sold with the promise of a radical response to corporate and institutional violence is Ubisoft's 2016 release, Watch Dogs 2. The game follows its protagonist, Marcus, through his induction into the fictionalized San Francisco hacktivist group, DedSec, his mission to bring down corrupt businessman, Dusan Nemec. The text offers an interesting exploration of classed and racialized interactions between the general public and big data corporations, with DedSec striving to combat the overstepping and weaponizing of that data. Marcus himself is a black man in America, and inevitably has personal experience of state and police violence as well. But perhaps it should come as no surprise that, as a AAA game, Watch Dogs 2 ultimately falls short in offering any genuine radical possibility. Like L.A. Noire, the setting of Watch Dogs 2 creates a sense of detachment between our present reality and the reality of the game world, while L.A. Noire uses chronology and the historical fiction genre to convince us that such violence is all in the past, Watch Dogs 2 is set in an alternative reality, a fictional 2016. The slightly futuristic feel created by visible surveillance technology, such as trams and security bots, aims to further separate our current experiences of the carceral city from those represented in the game. In fact, the technology of the carceral city does encroach on our lives in ways which are incredibly similar to those represented in the text, if only more invisibilized in our reality. For example, take the use of 3D printed weapons which can pass through metal detectors, of military and police robots similar to those developed by Boston Dynamics, of big data to manipulate voting intentions, as Facebook did with the 2016 election, and the ability to hack vehicles, technology that is currently being developed by police forces in the US. The main difference between how this technology is employed in Watch Dogs 2 and in the real world is that in Watch Dogs 2, private companies are exclusively responsible. Your enemies are not the carceral state, but the companies Bloom, responsible for the Central Operating System, CTOS, Umeni Security Corps, the private security company that operates throughout the city, Galilee, a private aerospace manufacturer, and Titus, a robotics and arms manufacturer which sells products to private companies. In reality, while companies, such as Microsoft, do play a huge role, this is very much in association with the state and its agents, the police and the military. This is the nature of the carceral. Capitalism and the state are inseparable. While none of the violent institutions in Watch Dogs 2 are run by the state, they do mirror real-world state institutions. The FBI and CIA, the San Francisco Police Department, NASA, and Boston Dynamics. Boston Dynamics is a private company, but a number of their projects were funded by or developed for the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, an agency within the United States Department of Defense. The desire to separate fictional and real-world institutions is cemented with the disclaimer that pops up every time you start the game. This is purely fiction. Any resemblance to real-world carceral violence is purely coincidence. Sure. Similar to L.A. Noire, an attempt is made to blame individual bad men and bad companies rather than assigning the responsibility where it belongs, with free market capitalism and with the carceral state. None of this would have happened if people had just followed the law, right? Where have we heard that before? In the words of Angela Davis, the neoliberal assertion that equality can only be achieved with the law, as well as individual subjects, becomes blind to race. This approach, however, fails to apprehend the material and ideological work that race continues to do. When the classed and racialized violence of the carceral appears in Watch Dogs 2, like when CTOS is revealed to be using class and race demographic data to create shoot-to-kill areas around the city, this is received with surprise, even though this harrowing scenario is the reality of present-day and historic policing in both the US and UK. Another way in which the violence of the carceral is represented in the game is through the representation of a military-to-police pipeline. Under the carceral, the military and domestic police are deeply intertwined, sharing tactics, personnel, and technology. For example, tear gas used by cops is manufactured by arms companies. The US and Israeli military train the US police force, and prisons turn incarcerated bodies into a source of profit for big business and the military. In Watch Dogs 2, this connection is illustrated through Titus's 10-year plan, which involves the increasing militarization of their security robots through the introduction of armor, tear gas, and automatic weapons. These developments were designed with both military and civil uses. However, within the game world, once again these devices are not accredited to the military, but to private business only. Surveillance is essential to the carceral and one of the main tools of policing in our society. Foucault says that our society is structured around a general mechanism of panopticonism, which is to say that because we cannot see the eyes of the state upon us but know that it could be watching us at any moment, we are in a constant state of feeling watched and being surveilled. In fact, this reduces the work of police officers because we often police ourselves to follow the law for fear of punishment. Society is also designed to prevent us from connecting with and acting in solidarity with one another, including the way mass surveillance instills the fear that if we are caught helping someone else, we might be punished, or the ways that gentrification of cities drive out working class communities and diminish public space in order to keep us apart. Surveillance is a key game mechanic throughout Watch Dogs 2, a game which very much centers visibility and invisibility. The observed is passive, an object of information that is seen by the institution but unable to see the mechanisms of power that surveil them. In Watch Dogs 2, the surveillance takes the form of data collection, internet browsing habits, political intentions, ethnicity, income, employment details, emotional state, medical records, criminal records, and so on. Sounds familiar, right? This comprehensive use of big data normalizes judgment where the smallest infringement has a disciplinary outcome. It creates a state where every member of the general public is conscious of a constant state of surveillance, and while the game frames this as unconstitutional and dystopian, it fails to draw parallels to how that same surveillance exists within our society. Whether it be through the never-ending reach of Facebook, Google, or any other tech giant in association with government intelligence, medical institutions, and the prison industrial complex. I could go on. The role of DedSec in this is interesting. First, they must actively break the law in order to operate. They engage in a kind of righteous lawlessness, something which in itself undermines the idea that the law is an arbiter of morality, hence also undermines the game's own internal logic, that if the bosses of these corporations simply followed the law, then everything would be fine. As a hacktivist group, they use panoptic methods against these bosses, surveilling them instead. The player hacks into the home or office networks of business people to gather information, observe them, and steal from them. After all, the philosophy of the carceral is that to know someone is to be able to control them. While this arguably is an effective method of taking power away by making the invisible hypervisible and accountable to the public, the onus is still placed on individuals rather than systems, and the use of carceral methods to fight the carceral is contentious at best. These political justifications and methods are further problematized by the wider activities of DedSec. While playing as Marcus, you have the ability to hack, surveil, and steal from any member of the public you may happen to pass. This unrestrained access and manipulation completely undermines the supposed political goal of dismantling capitalist and carceral power. DedSec pretty much just becomes the carceral by any other name. The questionable political and ethical nature of DedSec's activities, particularly the way in which it reinforces rather than meaningfully resists the carceral, is further interrogated through the Eye for an Eye mission. This mission sees Horatio, the only significant black character in the game besides from Marcus, murdered at the hands of a local gang, the Tezcas. Marcus, with the support of his DedSec associates, takes things into his own hands, hunting down those responsible, and murdering not only them, but any other member of the Tezcas in his way. Revenge for Horatio's death, both through capital punishment and the destruction of the Tezcas' funding resources, does nothing to resolve any of the issues that led to his murder. The systems of capitalism and racism that lead to the existence of organized crime and gangs won't go away because one gang has been decimated. It is no justice. Considering that the carceral describes not only the panoptic state, but the system of crime and punishment that this surveillance enables, this is a further example of DedSec embodying not resistance to the carceral, but simply the carceral itself. Led by queer people and people of color, and dressed up in a punk hacktivist aesthetic, but committing more or less the same violence. Watch Dogs 2, while using radical aesthetics and rhetoric, is caught in a neoliberal narrative that reinforces the violence of the state. This is reinforced constantly by DedSec propaganda videos that rely on American nationalist imagery, and morally justify their actions by referencing the US Constitution. Never mind that the American Constitution represents a state which was founded on the values of slavery, conditional personhood, racism, misogyny, genocide, and the destruction and theft of indigenous land and life. Watch Dogs 2 ends with all returning to the status quo. All wrongdoing is pinned on some bad apples, and the capitalist carceral state, in all its violent glory, lives on. Ultimately, the failure of Watch Dogs 2 is its inability to imagine any meaningful alternatives beyond state violence. Naughty Dog's The Last of Us Part 2 was without a doubt one of the most highly anticipated releases of 2020. Its predecessor, The Last of Us, released in 2013, had been lauded for many years not only for its gritty survivalist gameplay, thanks to its zombie apocalypse setting, but also its genuinely moving storytelling. I really mean it when I say the folks behind this game know narrative language like the back of their hands, and they know how to make you feel things. Everything from the fantastic work of actors, both through voice and motion capture technology, to sound and music direction, to the visual direction of cutscenes, to environmental storytelling through gameplay, comes together to make a deeply compelling narrative and interactive experience. I wish I was joking when I say the title sequence of The Last of Us makes me cry every time I play it. When it comes to The Last of Us Part 2, though there are many reasons why I hate the story they chose to tell, it would be amiss not to admit I think they told it well, though perhaps that's part of the problem. So, a little about this post-apocalyptic world and the relevant events of both games. The first game begins in 2013 with an outbreak of a mutant fungal virus which essentially turns people into zombies. Sara, the daughter of our lead character, Joel, is shot by a government soldier. Skip ahead to the year 2033 and we follow Joel and his fellow smuggler Tess through a world occupied by highly militarized government quarantine zones, some independent settlements, and those who wander alone. The leader of a group named the Fireflies, which opposes this military government presence, employs Joel and Tess to smuggle a girl named Ellie to another location. They discover that Ellie is immune to the virus, and that her immunity may lead to a cure, hence the need to smuggle her safely to a clandestine location. Tess dies, and the central relationship becomes the father-daughter bond between Joel and Ellie. Ultimately, Joel discovers that Ellie would not survive the surgery intended to create a vaccine, so he kills the lead surgeon, kills the leader of the Fireflies, and escapes with an unconscious Ellie who had been prepped for surgery. When Ellie wakes up, Joel claims that the Fireflies were unable to produce a cure. Ellie doesn't quite seem to believe him, but Joel is insistent in his lie. So ends the first game. 4 years later, in the year 2037, Ellie, Joel, and Joel's brother Tommy have built a life in a community called Jackson, but Ellie and Joel's relationship has become strained, as we later find out, because Ellie learns the truth about what Joel did to the Fireflies. A group of former Fireflies, now part of a Seattle group called the Washington Liberation Front, shortened to the WLF, or Wolves, torture and murder Joel. They are led by a woman named Abby, whose father was the surgeon that Joel had murdered at the end of the first game. Ellie arrives just in time to witness this, but her life is spared. She then sets out alongside her girlfriend Dina to seek revenge on Abby and the others who took part in this violence. Tommy leaves separately to go on his own revenge quest as well. As Ellie, the player learns about the war between the Wolves and a religious cult known as the Seraphites. While Ellie battles through Seattle, Abby's ex-boyfriend Owen goes missing and she goes looking for him, but is captured by the Seraphites and is rescued by two siblings and exiled Seraphites named Yara and Lev. Then a load of stuff happens, where they get caught in a war between the Wolves and the Seraphites and Yara dies and, well, there are reasons why I hate this plotline with a particular fire, but I'll go into that later. Abby and Ellie finally encounter one another in an aquarium where Ellie has just killed Owen and his pregnant girlfriend Mel, but Abby, who gains the upper hand during the fight, decides to spare them. Then, several months later, Abby and Lev end up on an island in their search for the Fireflies, and when Ellie discovers their whereabouts, she leaves the idyllic farmhouse where she now lives with Dina and their newborn baby. When Ellie finds Abby again, Abby has no intention of fighting anymore, but Ellie makes her, and this time she's the one who overpowers Abby. Then she decides she wants to spare Abby after all, but when she returns to the farmhouse, Dina and her baby are gone. The game ends as she remembered telling Joel that she would try to forgive him. If this summary of the second game began to feel tedious partway through, yeah. The Last of Us Part 2 is obviously a revenge story. Various aspects of its aesthetic, music direction, and plot particularly resemble the American Western. Revenge stories have been around for a long time, popularized during the early modern era with Shakespeare's Hamlet lauded in the Western canon as a nuanced revenge story that interrogates the morality and psychology of revenge, though Shakespeare was far from the only one of his contemporaries to write revenge plays. Many of these stories, like Hamlet, are those of powerful men seeking revenge on other men that have dared to displace their power. Sometimes they are those of a disenfranchised lower middle class man seeking revenge against men in power, usually while perpetuating misogyny themselves. Very occasionally, they might even include a subplot about a woman who manipulates a man to enact revenge for her and is punished for her gender deviance. More recently, though, we have seen the emergence of a subgenre of woman-led revenge stories which have begun to interrogate, or at least flip, the gender dynamics of the classic revenge story. These films often cast a woman as enacting violent revenge on a man or men in general, often ones who have abused them and or other women, for example Hard Candy or Promising Young Woman. Personally, with the exception of those which include unnecessarily graphic depictions of violence, particularly sexual violence, against these women as a preface to their revenge, I personally find this narrative structure more satisfying, and I know that many women and women-aligned people do. This isn't because I believe in violent justice at all. After all, I'm making this entire video to argue exactly the point that I don't think it's justice if it's violent, but because from a narrative and emotional point of view, it brings catharsis. We live in a world where women face relentless violence and no justice. I have faced gendered violence and received no justice. So it makes perfect sense that such revenge stories would bring emotional satisfaction to the part of you that wishes it could have fought back, the part of you that's angry that those things happened to you, that they happened to other women. Of course, violent retribution, including incarceration, does nothing to solve the systemic problem of violence against women, but it makes sense for your wronged emotional self to find satisfaction in a woman's violent revenge against her abuser, depicted in fictional form. And I don't doubt that if we lived in a just world, I'd feel differently. I wouldn't need the catharsis at all. But sometimes women-led revenge stories simply rehearse the dynamics of masculinist revenge stories, perpetuating systemic violence and upholding structures of power and oppression. The Last of Us Part 2, in my opinion, does exactly that. The text might disagree, or try to at least, arguing as it does that violence is cyclical and the desire for violent justice is in human nature, therefore inevitable. The structure of the game is relentlessly cyclical, to the point of tedium, in my opinion, cycling between the perspectives of Ellie and Abby, both to understand why they want revenge so much, and refusing to give the player a choice in committing violence. This is another point of interest for me. The game is as relentlessly linear as it is cyclical, refusing to incorporate any element of player choice. It wants us to believe that violence is natural to us, but it has to force us to partake in it. My experience of playing this game was relentlessly uncomfortable and eventually tiresome because it felt so forced, so drawn out, so hollow and needlessly full of hatred. The text is strewn with religious imagery as well, with the final horrible, unnecessary, long-winded, and violent encounter between Abby and Ellie taking a particularly biblical strain, first in the way that Ellie finds Abby strung up as if on a crucifix, then in their fight's twisted mimicry of baptism, or even of the first act of pointless violence by brother against brother. Lead director Neil Druckmann also tells us that this is what he believes, that hatred is inherent to human nature. In an interview for the Washington Post, he says, "I landed on this emotional idea of, can we, over the course of the game, make you feel this intense hate that is universal in the same way that unconditional love is universal? This hate that people feel has the same kind of universality. You hate someone so much that you want them to suffer in the way that they've made someone you love suffer." I find it interesting that Druckmann believes that hatred is a universal emotion. I find the example he discusses in this interview particularly interesting because it proves quite the opposite to me. Druckmann recounts to the Washington Post the hatred he felt when he saw footage of two Israeli soldiers being hanged in the West Bank in the year 2000. He conveniently misses out the fact that 100 Palestinians, including 24 minors, had been killed in the 2 weeks before this killing. Business as usual for the Israeli regime. Such hatred of Palestinians is not universal, but in fact highly political. The idea of the universality of hatred, of violence as inherent to human nature, is linked to propaganda that describes an ancient, so-called Israel-Palestine conflict. This narrative obscures the reality that Israel-Palestine is not a matter of a war between equal parties, but a matter of the bloody creation and maintenance of a settler colonial nation-state by means of systematic displacement, genocide, and apartheid. As we discuss further in our video on settler colonialism and indigeneity in video games, it is a matter of oppressor and oppressed. When Palestinians fight back, it's usually with stones in the face of guns, tanks, bombs, and a vast military apparatus. The hatred that someone like Druckmann is able to feel at the highly irregular event of the killing of two Israeli soldiers, without feeling any hatred towards said Israeli soldiers for the regular massacre of hundreds of Palestinians, is the result of the systematic dehumanization of Palestinians by the Israeli and Western propaganda machine. Hatred of the oppressed acting in retaliation, rather than hatred of the systemic violence of the oppressor, is certainly not universal. Would either form of hatred exist if not for the choice to colonize Palestine? The choice to create a system of apartheid? Are settler colonialism and apartheid natural phenomenon? No, of course not. And the same can be said of the text, of the political nature of The Last of Us Part II. As Emmanuel Mayberg argues in The Not-So-Hidden Israeli Politics of The Last of Us Part II, The Last of Us Part II presents what at first seems like an even-handed point of view, but perpetuates the very cycles of violence it's supposedly so troubled by. While some zombie fiction shows human depravity in response to fear or scarcity in the immediate aftermath of an outbreak, The Last of Us Part II takes place in a more stabilized post-apocalypse, decades after societal collapse, where individuals and communities choose to hurt each other as opposed to taking heinous actions out of desperation. Mayberg argues that the game does not present an impartial perspective on the universality of violence at all. It presents a staunchly Israeli perspective, a staunchly colonial perspective of violence. Indeed, violence in the world of The Last of Us Part II is not merely interpersonal, it's also structural. The war between the wolves and the Seraphites is not actually as much of a conflict between equals as this cycle of violence narrative wants it to be. Mayberg points out that the architecture of the wolves-controlled city of Seattle highly resembles the Israeli checkpoint system, and the Seraphites resemble Islamophobic tropes about Palestinians perpetuated by Israelis. That they are violent religious zealots and violently queerphobic, as shown by Lev's plotline in which he is exiled from the community for being trans, and when he tries to return to his mother, she attempts to murder him. The racist trope that Palestinians are violent, savage, backwards, and queerphobic is often used as a justification for Israeli settler colonial violence. Palestinians need to be civilized. In The Last of Us Part II, Abby operates as Lev's white savior, not only at the level of this Israel-Palestine allegory, but also at the surface-level narrative, where Abby is indeed a white woman and Lev is indeed a trans person of color. While the wolves control Seattle, a highly militarized power in control of resources and arms, the Seraphites fight with bow and arrow and, as Mayberg points out, have to navigate the city through an elaborate secret system of bridges between skyscrapers, which function as a kind of flipped version of the underground tunnels Palestinians use to bypass Israeli blockades and other means of limiting free movement in order to get supplies and carry out attacks on Israel. In fact, the wolves highly resemble FEDRA, the Federal Disaster Response Agency, the highly militarized government quarantine system that was developed in the aftermath of the outbreak. This parallel reinforces the idea that the wolves and Seraphites are not engaged in a conflict of equals. Rather, the wolves hold systematic and material power over the Seraphites. Such violence is, of course, not natural, but chosen and manufactured. In a world where violence and self-defense against the infected is not a choice, the narrative of The Last of Us Part II chooses instead to center that violence which is a choice, the systematic violence of the wolves and the interpersonal cycle of vengeful aggression between Ellie and Abby. It's worth adding that the interpersonal relationships in both The Last of Us and The Last of Us Part 2 are consistently defined by disturbing gendered and racialized dynamics, as I alluded to with Abby and Lev. The series is simply only interested in people of color in order to further the growth of its white protagonists, and in order to torture and subsequently efface their bodies, as Zara Lanier discusses in And She Was Less Than a Dog. The first game introduces the siblings Sam and Henry in order to further Ellie and Joel's mission, then kills them in order to further their character development. It introduces Marlene, leader of the Fireflies, to give Joel the mission which will bring him and Ellie together over the course of the game. Then it kills her when she threatens Ellie's life with the aim of developing a vaccine for the virus. The DLC, Left Behind, introduces Riley in order to inform the player that Ellie is queer by showing us that her and Riley were in love, then kills her in order for Ellie to discover that she, unlike Riley, is immune to the virus. The Last of Us Part 2 takes this pattern even further. Dina, a Jewish woman of color and Ellie's girlfriend, serves pretty much only as emotional and physical support to Ellie with little to no story or character of her own. For the player, she serves to humanize Ellie even as our protagonist commits heinous acts of violence. Ellie more or less fulfills the role of a male protagonist in a revenge-fueled Western here. How many times have you seen the man, lost in his quest for revenge, becoming alienated from his wife and child? Lev serves a similar purpose for our other white woman protagonist, Abby. He serves to humanize her after she tortures and murders Joel by allowing her to take a sisterly or even motherly role. The game even kills off Lev's biological sister Yara in order for Abby to fully occupy the role. At least Lev and Dina don't die, though. In contrast, Whitney and Manny, part of the group that helped Abby kill Joel, are murdered. Isaac, leader of the wolves, progresses Abby's plot, and then he's killed. The Seraphite with a warhammer who tries to kill Lev is a textbook racist caricature of a black man who Abby must kill in order to fulfill her white savior role. Jesse facilitates Dina's pregnancy, and then the child he fathers becomes the symbol for Dina and Ellie's relationship, taking the form of a heterosexist nuclear family in a world where adoption or artificial insemination likely aren't options. He also helps Ellie progress on her revenge quest before he's murdered. And then there's Nora, one of Abby's group, again, and one of Ellie's targets of revenge. But Naughty Dog doesn't just make you watch the torture of this black woman, they make you press the button. They don't give you a choice, but they make you press the button so you feel responsible. The racist violence of this game, then, doesn't just exist at the level of allegory, but at the surface level of narrative and even the literal action of the game. In their piece on the Israeli politics of The Last of Us Part 2, Mayberg concludes, "Whereas Abby and Ellie find interpersonal resolution at the end, the game seems content to leave the question of community-scale cycles of violence as a regrettable fact of human existence. Even if the wolves and scars meet their mutual end, the game leaves us with the knowledge that a resistance group from the first game, the Fireflies, and other groups are regrouping and gaining strength. The cycle continues." Ironically, then, the game forces the player to partake in violence in order to give the impression that violence and hatred are natural phenomena, but all the violence that is the subject matter of the game's narrative is entirely unnecessary. It is constructed. It is a choice. The game gives us a crumb by ending on the memory of the promise to forgive, but at least for me, this is far from enough. While The Last of Us Part 2's focus on revenge makes it a particularly good case study, it's far from the only post-apocalyptic future so hopeless and full of needless violence. Whether it's The Walking Dead or the Fallout series, these worlds project the violence of our own world, both presently and historically, onto the future. They are incapable of imagining futures without violence, certainly without violent justice, because they hold at their core the belief that violence is in human nature, therefore justice can only be violent. These games argue that the future of human society is what it supposedly always has been, more violence. But often, as we've seen, this fails to differentiate between structural and interpersonal violence, and it fails to see violence as a choice. Constructing violence as inevitable and apolitical is, in itself, political, a justification and excuse for further violence. At this point, it's evident that whether fantasy RPGs, real-world detective mysteries, or post-apocalyptic futures, video games rely on present-day structures and values of violent justice, incarceration, and punishment in order to construct their worlds and narratives. Sold as new worlds and imagined futures, they simply retell the same stories and normalize the violence of our society. So what does the future hold? Or, more importantly, what could it hold? Video games seem to me the perfect creative medium, in many ways, to imagine abolitionist futures, to imagine a world beyond the carceral, beyond violence. Not merely to imagine such worlds, but to build them. All storytelling is world-building in some way, of course, but what other opportunities are there to literally create a self-perpetuating abolitionist system? First, it's vital to discuss the conditions in which games are made, and the conditions which they perpetuate. The video game industry has been married to the military-industrial complex for as long as it's been around, and frankly, it's about time for a divorce. We've discussed some of these links in our video on settler colonialism and indigeneity in video games, from HP's development of surveillance technology to Microsoft's use of military hardware, including the use of Xbox controllers to control tanks and drones. It's no wonder military first-person shooters and their glorification of masculinist military violence has such a chokehold on the content of our games. It's what funders want, after all. In his book Marx at the Arcade, Jamie Woodcock outlines just a few of these links, including the use of military consultants in the creation of Call of Duty, the association between DARPA, the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency, and games developers, the use of modified versions of games like Doom 2 to train military personnel, and payments from gun manufacturers to game developers in order to include their guns represented in a positive light, associated with a hero, for example, within the text. Furthermore, the conditions of work at many AAA studios, despite repeated debates about the dangers of crunch, force workers into the drudgery of sometimes 70-hour weeks, forced to sign NDAs and confined to their departments, so they might not even know much about what game they're working on. It comes as no surprise that these conditions of work and violence also throttle the conditions of our imagination and play. So to imagine abolitionist futures, transformative and compassionate worlds within our games, we must equally imagine, and work towards, creating and playing games in such a reality. That said, there are games that have something of abolitionist futures, something of a radical imagination, within them. You feel this as you play them, and it does feel like play. Think of Animal Crossing New Horizons, for example. In this game, there is currency in the form of bells, but importantly, the conditions of your survival are not dependent on wage labor. Even in the new Happy Home Paradise DLC, which introduces a new form of currency which is earned through wage labor, this is entirely optional. It's for the ability to buy rare furniture and not for your survival. Back in the game, bells can be used to pay for upgrades to your house, but you don't need to pay rent and you cannot be evicted from your home. You don't need to eat either, so you don't have to pay for food. You don't need to engage in capitalist work in order to obtain bells, so any work you do in the game can feel joyful and nourishing. Bells are instead a more or less natural resource which can be found in the ground, rocks, and in trees. For the most part, this isn't perfectly analogous to the colonial capitalist exploitation of natural resources, because it doesn't quite decimate indigenous land and life on the scale that empires have done and continue to do, but it does feel a little suspect that you can plunder islands for bells and then, if there are any residents on those islands, invite them to yours once you've destroyed their home. There is something to be said too for how in games like this, your relations with others are transactional, defined by the exchange of money or gifts, not a free or loving or caring relation by any means. So long as a money economy exists within the game world then, Animal Crossing doesn't quite offer a post-capitalist future, But there is something to be said for how, because survival is not dependent on wage labor, the conditions of the carceral are all but gone. You don't see military, police, surveillance, courts, prisons, or corporations in Animal Crossing, do you? And doesn't it feel so free? Even many of the most utopic games have a money economy, though rarely an honest-to-God free market capitalist economy in some form, from Stardew Valley to Harvest Moon. But these games feel safe and comforting because labor is largely for its own sake, for nourishment and for joy, and because your survival is not at risk and it isn't dependent on money. Labor doesn't feel so much like drudgery when our survival isn't dependent on it, when we can choose the labor we do. And the implied effects of this are a clear reduction of the conditions that lead to most crime. This is something of an abolitionist future. What do I mean when I talk of abolitionist futures? What do I imagine? To abolish systems of harm in our society means many things. To abolish borders so that people can move and live and exist freely. To abolish capital so that all people can live in free and accessible housing. To abolish capitalist work so that we can feel joy in what we do, no longer dependent on the drudgery of a job we hate, or worse, a job we wanted to love but couldn't anymore. To abolish all forms of medical gatekeeping so that we can be free to live happy, healthy lives in which we have autonomy over our bodies. To abolish the military and the police so that we do not have to live in fear of violence. To abolish all forms of incarceration for all people, from prisons to detention centers to psychiatric hospitals and more, so that no one ever has to live in a cage. To abolish the suffocation of the nuclear family structure, to love and care for one another freely. And to abolish all this, think of the possibilities. Think of movement, safety, love, joy, freedom, care, and what they could mean. Think of the world in our gentle hands. That, my friend, is justice. Think of justice not as an end in and of itself, but as work. Not as capitalist work, but as something iterative, something we do, something we create. Think of justice as the work of imagining and building towards a just world. In the words of Angela Davis, you have to act as if it were possible to radically transform the world, and you have to do it all the time. Thank you so much for taking the time to watch this video. If you enjoyed it, please do give it a like and be sure to comment. As always, a huge thank you to our patrons who make videos like this possible. We genuinely couldn't do this without you. Special thanks to our ambassador patrons, Beatrix Livesey Stevens, Fizzlefur, and Morgan Paul. If you aren't a patron already, please do consider supporting us over at patreon.com/gameassistyt. Catch us over on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram for further discussions and conversations, and as always, thank you for watching. Take care.